Throughout the past week, names of potential Biden cabinet members have come out, with one name in particular causing a little bit of a controversy. Rahm Emanuel, former Obama alum and mayor of Chicago. Much of that pushback has come from progressives.
Here to discuss are Democratic strategists Jennifer Holdsworth and Rachel Bovard, Senior Director of Policy at the Conservative Partnership Institute. Always great to see you, ladies.
Good to see you.
Good to see
you. Good morning.
So, Jennifer, let me start with you on Rahm Emanuel. So, I noted yesterday you saw what appeared to be a coordinated effort, AOC, Jamal Bowman, Mondaire Jones, and others putting out really strenuous, aggressive statements against him having any involvement in the Biden administration. Mondaire Jones says Rahm Emanuel covered up the murder of a black teenager, Laquan McDonald, while he was mayor of Chicago. That he's being considered for a cabinet position is completely outrageous and honestly very hurtful. This is the person that I've seen progressives most go to the mat over. There's been some concerns about Michelle Flournoy and Tony Blinken and others. But this one, the level of response seems to be above and beyond, in my view, for good reason. Do you think that they'll ultimately be successful in spiking him from any role in this administration?
Well, first, I think we have to take the discussion of his inclusion in the cabinet with a grain of salt anyway. I think that a lot of what's been speculated in the media has not proven to be true. I also think it's a little bit suspect that this particular rumor came out in Crane, Chicago, which is a very niche outlet. I don't think this is speculation coming from within the Biden camp. I think this is speculation coming from Chicago. I actually think that, unfortunately, this is you know, raising the ire of progressives when hopefully it doesn't need to be. But yeah, short answer, yes, I think that they will be successful because I don't see, and I'm not going to speak from experience here. I've not spoken to anybody in the Biden transition about this, but I just don't see room for him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think it's interesting. Well, you know, I should note, Rachel, it's not just progressives who are upset. I mean, the idea of Rahm Emanuel in the trade office, the guy who worked for Clinton and Obama, TPP, the fake pivot to Asia, and all of that, I mean, it seems just as objectionable to somebody like me. What do you think, Rachel?
Yeah, my favorite part about this story was that when they were like, well, we'll put him at transportation. Oh, well, but maybe we'll put him in a less visible role in the trade office.
Yeah,
less
I was like,
visible,
no!
Maybe, yeah. But like far more consequential. I mean, this is the guy that pushed through NAFTA. You can argue he's further to the right on trade than a lot of Republicans these days. Mm-hmm. And, you know, say what you will about the Trump administration, but under the leadership of Robert Lighthizer, they renegotiated NAFTA and took on sort of the free trade theology that very much infected their own party. Rahm Emanuel would just send that backwards. But I think more broadly speaking, you know, Rahm Emanuel's inclusion or not, I think there's a complete lack of curiosity from the Biden administration about who else could do these jobs. Like, it's 2008 all over again.
Yeah.
It's the same parade of people, the same careerists that have been running the Democrat Party for years. And Rahm Emanuel is just another one of those.
I think that's right.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's more or less fair, Jen. But I also think, you know, in a lot of ways, that's exactly what Biden advertised. Like, no one's going to be surprised that he's bringing back the Obama cast of characters, many of whom I find objectionable, many of whom I think have conflicts of interest here. But ultimately, it's exactly what he told voters he would do. And he's bringing back the old band back from like 2008 and 2012.
Well, yes and no. I mean, I think that, yes, President-elect Biden is going to be a very steady leader, right? We were all over Donald Trump about bringing in these ridiculous characters from all over the place with absolutely no experience in government. We want somebody who is going to know what they're doing at the helm, right? So I think what President-elect Biden is doing is he's like you said, Crystal, he's bringing everybody who has this experience back to government. I think that you're going to see already an overwhelming number of women that are serving in the cabinet, an overwhelming number of persons of color in various leadership positions who have not been held by persons of color before. So I think that you're going to see a very specific focus on making sure that people have experience, making sure that there's representation, but also making sure that they can get the job done, because I don't think anybody could argue that we're not in an extremely precarious spot. So yes, there has to be new blood in an administration, but I think he's doing exactly what the doctor ordered.
Yeah, well, what do you make of that, Rachel? Because at the same time, look, I mean, Biden is being very authentic to himself. Now, you know, I was objected to that from the beginning, and I warned about what a bitter pill it is to have normalcy. I mean, we were just talking here about how, you know, they were considering Michelle Flournoy for the defense secretary, And apparently somebody on the team was like, well, she has ties to the defense industry, so maybe not. But their alternative is Jay Johnson, who is a board member of Lockheed Martin. And so you're like, oh, so like, should I choose between a lobbyist and a board member? That just seems kind of ridiculous in terms of the standards that are being set. What do you think?
Yeah, it's just a broad lack of reflection, I think, at all. Mm-hmm. Like, the slogan of the campaign was Build Back Better, right? But that requires you to actually reflect at what you got wrong.
Yeah,
and the Democrat Party, you know, they're just bringing back the same old people, regardless of their successes or failures. Like, Tony Blinken has been wrong about every major foreign policy question in the last 20 years. And so he got obviously naturally promoted to Secretary of State because the foreign policy blob, it doesn't matter what you get right, you still get better jobs. And so, you know, they haven't engaged, I think, in the introspection to actually build back better. They're just building back sort of, you know, the foundation that existed before.
Build
back same.
Yeah.
Yeah. Would Jen respond to that? What's your view of that? Because Rachel's basically making the point, yeah, experience, sure, but experience in what? Experiencing, you know, being in favor of the Iraq war, and experience in being in favor of going even further in Syria, experience in bombing Libya. Like, those experiences don't really highly recommend a lot of these people.
Right. But I think learning from experience is important, too. I think that a lot of people who supported the Iraq war are horrified that they did. Right. And I think that if you have that type of introspection and admit that you were wrong, you're going to be a lot more suspect of intelligence that comes your way in the future. So I don't necessarily think that it's bad experience. I know that President-elect Biden has spoken repeatedly that he regretted supporting the Iraq war. Let's not forget that they were lied to just boldface by the, you know, W administration in order to get into that war. So I think that there was a lot of misrepresentation there. So look, a lot of the foreign policy decisions in the last 20 years were based on that horrendous decision, right? And I think that there's a lot of introspection there, not the other way around.
Well, I hope so. And if any of them were as contrite as you're laying out, I'd be a lot happier about it. But we have more Rising for everybody right after this. Stick with us.